to discuss whether his army of 10,000 could defeat the 20,000 soldiers marching against him. And if he cannot, he will send a delegation to discuss terms of peace while the enemy is still far away. So you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own. This is discipleship, but first I want to talk about childship. Because this is a resurrection, this is an Easter story. Childship refers to John chapter 1, verse 12. It's one of my favorite verses. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. This is just awesome to me that I have become a child of God. And I am an heir to everything that God has. I am an heir. I will inherit the whole of creation because I am a child of God. That is childship. And if you think about it, I will think about this almost every day. Because it's so impossible. How can I, a sinner, how can I, so imperfect, ever become a child of God? I cannot even see myself as a child of God. But yet I know God looks at me as a child of God. He has imputed his fatherhood to me. Isn't it just, think about it. Every morning I go and I look myself in the mirror, oh, I have a new wrinkle. Oh, my bags under my eyes are growing bigger. I have less hair, all sorts of imperfections. And then when I go out to pray, I said, I'm a child of God. Close your eyes right now. I always ask you to do this, but I want you to close your eyes. And just say from the bottom of your heart, I am a child of God. Ako ay anak ng Diyos. It's, our Philippine language is more touching. Anak ng Diyos. Child of God. And it's, you just reflect that every day, you, it's just super. And that is childship. The beautiful thing about this is childship is a free gift. It is free. It's free. It's a gift. It's a gift I do not even deserve. It's a gift I cannot ever be worthy of. That is childship. It's free because look, the only condition to become a child of God is to believe in Jesus Christ and accept Him as my Savior, as my Lord. That's all. There's practically no cost to childship. And the childship was established today on Resurrection Sunday. Because when Christ rose from the dead, he conquered death forever for us. He opened the gates of heaven for us, allowing us to come before the Father and become his child. That happened today. So we celebrate Easter, or rightfully Resurrection Sunday. That's when the gates of heaven were opened for you and me to freely accept childship, this free gift. It didn't cost you anything to believe in Christ, did it? It didn't cost you anything to accept Him as Lord and Savior. It just the only cost was a few words of proclamation. It is free. And you and I, we are children of God, anak ng Diyos. Fantastic, isn't it? Continue to think about it. Reflect on child. Reflect on off. Reflect on God. God. We are a child of God. Reflect on, I am going to inherit creation. Because that's the entitlement of a child. We will inherit. What is our parents? So we inherit the whole of creation. Science hasn't even figured out how big this universe is. They're just guessing how many billions and trillions and quadrillions of stars there will be. There is. They're just guessing how many miles it is. Child of God. That is how vast our inheritance is. Just think of that. Just think of that. And it will overwhelm us. It always overwhelms me. And I have no, it gives me no choice but to love God the way He would like me to love Him. For this Easter week, I would like you to make it a holy habit to reflect on that. John 1:12, I am a child of God. I am an heir to all of creation. Wow! Isn't it a wow?
Yeah.
Unbelievable. I am a child of God. That is childship. Unique to our church. It started, I checked it. Dictionary. There was no childship. There's a sonship, but there's no such childship. But then, that's what it is. So that's childship. It's free, contrasted to discipleship. Disciple means to become a student, a learner, a pupil, a follower. That was it. That's what discipleship is. In fact, the disciple and believer is mentioned more often than being a Christian. I think that Christian is only mentioned once or twice, depending on the verse we use. It's only once or twice mentioned. But believer and disciple, that's what we are. Believer is free, and in contrast, discipleship has a cost. And if you look at the Bible here, start my Bible here. There's a subtitle before Luke 14:25, which started our reading. It says, the cost of being a disciple. So, discipleship is this. When you go to war, you have to figure out if you have enough resources to win the battle. Otherwise, don't fight. It means that if you're a disciple, then you have to figure out if you can have what it takes to become a disciple. Kaya ko ba? Can I do it? Of course we can do it because we're a child of God. And God has given us everything. When God calls, He provides the resources. He equips. When God calls us, As we are called to become a child of God, He has equipped us to become a disciple. All we have to do is figure out specifically what is the cost. Before you build the tower, don't begin until you count the cost. So what is the cost of being a disciple to you? It has a cost. And the death of Christ is childship. Resurrection Sunday, that has a cost. Easter Monday has a cost. And you and I have to understand this. What is this cost all about? What is the cost of following Jesus? So there have been many teachings on this. Being following Jesus Christ is reading the Bible. And there are many things here that says, how do we live a life of a believer? Okay. The epistles, and I have a lot of it. And very often, that's what we talk about. But today, the inspiration we have that I want to share with you is the cost of following Jesus. When you follow somebody, you follow him to go where? So it says here, if you want, so verse 26, if you want to be my disciple, you must hate everyone else by comparison. Hate your mother, hate your father, hate your wife, hate your children, hate your brothers and sisters. Yes, even your own life. If you don't hate, otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. Now, of course, this hate here is just what is called a rhetorical thing. What it really means is, hate here means you must desire someone less than someone else. That's what hate here means. I'm desiring my parents, my brothers and sisters, less than I desire what? Being a disciple. Putting it the other way around, discipleship is desiring someone more than someone else. So instead of saying, I'm hating my brothers and sisters, my father and my mother, and my friends in my own life, I'm loving Christ more than my brother, than my sister, my mother and my father, than my own life. That's what it means. Okay? That's what hate means. Jesus Christ used this hate as a figure of speech because in those times he knew that being a believer, he or she would be hated by even the mother and the father, the brother and the sister. Because they would stop initially becoming Jews. You would stop, if you were a Roman, worshiping the Roman gods and the emperor, but start worshiping the living God. Therefore, you would be hated. Therefore, you must hate back. That's the way he was speaking, but he's saying, you must love God more than everything else in your lives. That is the cost of discipleship. The other parts of the Bible says, when I come, there will be a sword of division between husband and wife, between mother and father, between husband and wife, daughter and child. There is a division. Because one is a believer, one is not. One lives in the world of light, the other lives in the world of darkness. It's divided. One worships Christ, the other one worships something else. It could be money, it could be golf, it could be basketball. I mean, you know, it's just a matter of saying, now Christ is more important than anything else. In my case, it's more important than drinking and smoking. So that's what it means. The cost of discipleship is loving Christ above all else. And that hurts. That really hurts. How many friends have you lost when you became a believer? Of course you would avoid. I would avoid all my friends because all my friends were the drunkards. And I had to let them all go. My old gang, my barcada. And I had to develop new ones. Even today, you know, we're a family of 11 boys and girls. Even today, some of my siblings do not talk to me. And I was born again, March 66 minus 38, 26, a quarter of a century ago. That's the cost. So think of the cost to you. I'm sure there are some friends who are not friends anymore, right? And you have new friends. I mean, we're all here. We're all new. We just met a couple of years ago. The last passage of our study. So you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own. Wow. It just means that you put everything that we own to be used as God would like us to use it. That is a surrender. Everything is for God's glory. That is the cost of discipleship. And there have been many studies on that. But today, I bring forward an additional insight. So what is the cost of following Jesus? First of all, we have to find out, where am I following Jesus to? When you follow somebody, and that somebody is moving, wherever that somebody is going, that's where you want to go. Right? So where is Jesus Christ taking us now? Anybody can have a guess? Where are we going? The most common answer is heaven. But you're already in heaven. We're saying you can follow Christ to eternal life. But you and I are already part of eternal life. Our souls will forever be with Christ. So where specifically? There is a specific event in history where you and I should be looking to. I personally look at this event, future event in history. Because that's where Christ will be, for sure. And I want to be with Him. It's in Scripture. There. I want you to go there and mark your Bible. This is very important. Because it is a scriptural basis for the saying, Christ died, Christ has risen, and Christ will
come again.
This is part of it. This is Christ's second coming, part one. Okay, part one. Have you heard of the rapture? This is the passage of the rapture of the church. For the Lord Himself, verse 16 of 1 Thessalonians 4:16. For the Lord Himself will come down from heaven with a commanding shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the first trumpet call of God. Let's stop here. People say this is thunder. People say this is lightning. People say this is an explosion. People say it could be a nuclear bomb that ends the world. But there will be a commanding shout and a call of the trumpet. Call from God. What happens then? First, the Christians who have died will rise from the graves. So my dad, who died many years ago, I'm older than my dad now, he died when he was 54, I'm now 66. And he will rise again from the dead. All your friends who are believers who have died will rise again from the dead. They will rise from their graves. But you're saying, hey, but they're already in heaven. They're with Christ. But you know, we're not sure about space and time when we die. Or space and time in the kingdom. It could just be a split second or simultaneous, right? Whatever it is, those who have died before us will rise from their graves. Because they will have to convert their earthly bodies into spiritual bodies. Let's talk about in Corinthians. We will have a new body. A body that will withstand space. A body that can move around by the thought. I want to go to Jupiter. Boom, I'm there. Without a spacesuit. Because my spiritual body can be there. Our bodies, they say, if you notice in the resurrection story, when the woman went to the cave, and then the angel talked to them, they bowed down. When Daniel was confronted with the angel, he would bow down. Because they believed that man could not survive looking at God. Because it's just so powerful. But then we will be given a new body that will allow us to survive looking at God. Because we will be with Him. So first, the Christians who die will rise from the graves. Verse 17. Then, together with them, we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. Then we will be with the Lord forever. I think you've seen this movie, right? What's that movie of Nicolas Cage recently? Left Behind. The ones who are left behind are those who will not be raptured to the clouds. So what's going to happen here is Christ at this stage, His second coming part one, He will just be there in the air. And He will rise up with our spiritual bodies to meet Him. That is where we are going, to meet Christ in the air. When you say, where will I follow Christ? I want to meet Him in the air. I want to be there, whether I'm alive or dead, I will be there to meet Him. Can you imagine that we'll just be soaring there in the atmosphere, floating there with Christ, worshiping Him? I will see my dad. I'm longing to see my father. On the night my father died, I knew he was dying, but I hated him so much, I didn't go to his house. He was in pain, they say, but one day, as he was in pain, he says, Lord, I'm sorry. Apparently the pain stopped and he died. He died, me hating him. I look forward to me. I know when I meet Christ, I will be, hey, Papa! I will embrace my dad. And whoever else went before you, who's dear to you, will be there. We will meet Faye. You'll meet Faye there in heaven. Remember Faye? We will meet her there. She's waiting for us. Church, that is where you should be following. You must be conscious that. You see, when there is a cause, you have to have a plan. You have to plan where to go. This is the plan. This is where we will follow Jesus to eventually, to be caught up in the air with Him. Paul, at that time, thought that he wouldn't die, that he would be this. That's why he said, we who are still alive, he thought Christ would be coming in his lifetime. we who are still alive and remain on the earth will be caught up with him. For Paul, it was so real. And it's important for you to make this real. To make it a real. I want to be there. I want to be there. And that was 2,000 years ago. So I don't know. A lot of people say that I thought for a while that I would meet Christ in my lifetime. I still could. I have about 30 years to go. That is where we will follow Christ, to the rapture. We want to be raptured there. And I want you to start fixing this as a vision for your personal relationship with Christ. I want to follow Christ, to meet him in the air, as described in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 17. Part two of the present coming is when he will physically land on earth, in the Mount of Olives near Jerusalem, where the place where he ascended into heaven, is the very same place he will land. And those who were raptured with Christ will land with him there. I've been there. One day we should go there. I have kissed the ground where Christ will come back to earth physically. And my prayer is that I will be with him there physically to step up on the mountain. So I've been ahead of you guys. Where Christ will be, where he left, I've been there. It's just outside Jerusalem. When you're there, you can see the Jerusalem. And they say that the olive trees there have been theirs when Christ wept in the agony in the garden. The Mount of Olives. That's in Zechariah. Okay, the last chapter of Zechariah talks about that. That is where Zion, the Mount of Zion, will emerge. So when Christ lands on the Mount of Olives, the Mount of Olives will be split into two to make way for the Mount Zion, which is the heavenly Jerusalem. Right now, I'm just happy with part one. I want to be raptured. If he arrives tomorrow, I don't want to be left behind. And you wouldn't want your loved ones to be left behind, right? So you got to work and pray that your loved ones will be believers, so they will not be left behind. So what is the cost of following Jesus Christ to the rapture? This is the cost. First, so you mark this, Romans 11, 25 to 26. Mark your Bible, this is very important. Romans 11, 25. We will just read to the first sentence of verse 26. That's why it's 26a. I want you to understand this mystery, dear brothers and sisters, so that you will not feel proud about yourselves. Some of the people of Israel have hard hearts. The Jews have hard hearts. But Christ was a Jew, and yet they rejected him. That's what this means. Some of the people of Israel have hard hearts. But this hardness of the heart of the Jewish people, but this will last only until the full number of the Gentiles comes to Christ. So all Israel will be saved. Israel will become a Christian nation. All Israel will be saved. And the rapture will probably not come, I'm guessing. to come tomorrow. What am I saying here? So we'll read this verse in the New International Reader's Version, like the NIV for readers, NIRB. Brothers and sisters, here is a mystery I want you to understand. It will keep you from being proud. Part of Israel has refused to obey God. This disobedience will continue until the full number of non-Jews has entered God's kingdom. Then all Israel will be saved. God has in His mind, and it's in His plan, is a finite number of non-Jews that will enter heaven, and then all Israel will be saved. When Israel is saved, then the end of the world will come. Remember, the story of Armageddon means that Israel will be attacked by an army of 200 million. From the east. And the east of Jerusalem is really what? Iraq, Iran, Turkey. Even parts of Russia. All the way to China. And India, of course. That's where the mass of humanity will be. But then, you see, there's a full number of Gentiles or non-Jews that have to enter God before Israel will be saved, before Christ comes again to the earth. What is the implication? The cost of following Christ to the rapture means that we have to have a burden for lost souls. For all you know, the next person you talk to and convince to become a believer, he could be the full number. He could be it. Wow! Then rapture comes. Maybe the next person who comes to this church and accepts Christ as Lord and Savior, he could be the full number of non-Jews or Gentiles. When you think of it that way, becomes encouraging. Okay, maybe the next person, I want to meet Christ in the air. Whether I've died before that or... But it's not going to happen until the full number of the Gentiles come in. Therefore, I'm passionately looking for lost souls so that they can be brought to the kingdom. He could be the best friend of yours who comes for Christ. He could be it. He could be the full number of the Gentiles. And then Israel will be saved. And then the countdown to the second coming begins. The cost of following Christ, part of it is having a burden for lost souls. Amen? And we pray today. So we will have no more fear in this, our adopted nation. We have no more fear to bring in, to be part of the effort to bring in the full number of the Gentiles into the kingdom. No fear. Because God said, I will go before you. Isaiah 66, it refers to Filipinos. That is the special calling of World International. I don't know, I posted a picture yesterday of this big conference of the leaders of World International Ministries, MM. Europe, Middle East, Mediterranean. Those are the leaders. It's just a big crowd. I was surprised. Because we are pretty big in that part of the world too. And, being a believer in the Middle East is a a different experience because that's illegal. And yet they do it at the risk of death. So I really look up to those guys in the Middle East. Our Dubai church is now 25 years old. It's one of the earliest been churches established. I just read, I saw their, I'll post it, it's their 25 year celebration. It coincided with that convention. I want to share with you our vision. Roman and I presented this to the meeting in Vancouver. So this is now our approved vision. Eventually we will change our name, Word International Ministries, Atlantic Canada. So that's our, we are the seed for Atlantic Canada. Our vision is to be an Atlantic Canada community of churches. This is just the first. As a church, we are committed to fulfilling the Great Commission of helping to establish the kingdom of God in the hearts of men, women, and children. That is the burden for souls. As a church, I have not brought you to this part of the program, of the vision. But we're going there starting today. The second portion of our vision, and this is what we've been doing for the past 3 or 4 years, is to build communities of families where lives, regardless of their origins or status, are transformed to reflect the image of Jesus Christ. I would like you to look at the person on your left and say, "Hi, Jesus. I see Jesus in you. Come on, I see Jesus in you." That's what we've been doing. "Hey, Gabe, I see Jesus in you." If you want to see how does Jesus look like, look at the person beside you. That's how Christ looks like. Isn't it, wow? I look like Christ? This is what we've been doing as a church. But now I'm just kind of promulgating our vision. It is now for Atlantic Canada. And our mission is being this. Our mission is to bring the unsaved and nominal Christians to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ by planting churches in the multicultural urban centers of Atlantic Canada, where leaders are going to be developed and discipled to proclaim the gospel. And I'm sure we will have more pastors. Because you can't have churches without pastors. We have a marching order to go to PEI, Charlottetown, because there are 2,000. There are as many Filipinos there as we have here in Halifax. So I want you to start thinking of, you know, where is Jaja now? New Brunswick? Maybe we should get in touch with her. Maybe she can do something there. Yarmouth. Who's in Yarmouth? Maybe we can do something there, right? There's somebody in Bridgewater, in Mahon Bay, Eric. I know there are Filipinos serving there in Bridgewater, in the McDonald's, I've seen them. So I'm going to call up, what's his name, Eric, too. Hey, maybe we can do an outreach Bible study. Let's follow up called the Village. The outreach Bible study is going to be a main weapon, which means that wherever they are, we'll gather them to a Bible study. As an outreach, to reach out to them. The way we started, we started as a Bible study. Right? But start looking at that. We are now tasked to look at Atlantic Canada. And can I have volunteers? So I left some there, but these are just memory cards. Somebody help her so we can distribute it. So start thinking of outreach. Where for the past years we have been worshiping, we have been relationship and discipleship. Now we have to start doing the outreach. Go into the whole world and preach the good news to everyone. Bring a lot so you can give it to your friends or people who are absent here. There's more there on the reception table. But as a church, we should start now developing this burden for souls. Manifested is in establishing churches. In 2012, when I first attended a pastor's meeting, our international board, the WIN International Board, that was then they decided the next step for WIN churches is to start having real estate. It's going to be part of our vision. We should have a church building. So start praying for that. So Vancouver, we have a nice building that we own. I don't know what happened, but when we left in Vancouver, Pastor John was negotiating for another building to be purchased in Toronto for them. I posted a picture of the mother of the Wynn Church of Myra, Wynn Better Living. Well, we already have a building. Wynn Better Living used to be just in front of our beauty parlor. And every once in a while, Jude and I would worship in Wynn Better Living. But now they have a building, the way I saw it. So that's part of it. Our mission is to bring the unsaved and nominal Christians, to a saving knowledge of Christ Jesus by church planting. And our main model of development is Bible studies. So think, somebody who's a good friend of Jaja, just ask her, outreach Bible study. Maybe you can just have pray about it, but there are many things we can do. Look at Eleanor again. I don't know if there are Filipinos there, but that's how we start. We use the Philippine nation as a springboard. Now, in our case, as a church, we're a little bit more advanced than other churches. I think when we had that leaders meeting with Pastor Joe, and he showed pictures of the Wynn Toronto church, she complained, hey, they're all Filipinos. So we're a little bit more advanced. We have two whiteys. We have two Latin, you know. And maybe Rick was brought to Mahon Bay, which is his home. Because I've been praying for the Filipinos there. Whenever I go to Bridgewater, I would pray for the Filipino workers I meet in Subway, McDonald's. I'd pray for them. And it just occurred to me the other day that Rick is there. Therefore, maybe we can start something. It's just an hour away, an hour and a half away. Okay? That's our mission. And today, the cost of following Jesus means we have to keep our eyes on the rapture and help to accelerate the coming of the rapture by bringing in the full number of the Gentiles and non-Jews into the kingdom of God. Be inspired. The next person, the person you talk to, he becomes a Christian, he could be the full number. He could be the Lord's number. Whenever I think of that, I get excited because I would like this to come. I don't want to suffer anymore in this body. As time goes by, you know, there are more creaks, more hurts. right now, these two fingers, I can't do this, it's painful. He says, I want to escape this body now. I want to be with Christ forever. Amen? That is the cost of following Jesus Christ. Pursuing the rapture. It becomes kind of automatic if you start falling in love with the idea of meeting Christ in the air, and if that could happen tomorrow, then there is sufficient encouragement to really start sharing the good news with others. With a specific idea of bringing them to church or establishing churches elsewhere. So we start praying for them. For example, last, we've activated this youth gathering, okay? The youth. So it's hard to bring people to church. Bring them to the youth gathering. Bring them to their life group. Or bring them to the couples gathering. I understand there are a lot of non-church goers, or those who just come every once in a while, will be joining the women's retreat. Because Julie has been inviting non-church members, and a number of them are going to join. Including, she's reaching out to those who previously joined us in the Bible study. Some of them will be joining on that April 9th gathering. So we have those on-ramps to bring them to church. And we should start thinking that way. Amen? Okay, let me pray for you. But I prayed for you already for the fear. So let's just stand up for the Lord's blessing. Church, may the Lord bless you and protect you. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you. And may the Lord show you His favor and give you His peace. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. See you at home.